Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110. Now, here's this week's message. The alarm clock hits. It's time for work. 9 to 5, 9 to 5, and sometimes longer. The same routine, the same people, day in and day out, Monday through Friday. And on Sunday night, the Monday blues kick in. But what if there was something more to my work? What if I was there for a purpose? Jesus tells us that we are a light to the world. If I'm a light, then I shouldn't hide it, but display it. My work isn't just a place to make a paycheck, but a place to live out the purpose of God. What if we live each day with a purpose? Work wouldn't just be work, but redefined to be exactly where God wants us to be, for purposes that are beyond what we could dream of.
Good morning. How are you? Well, we are in a series, Redefining Work. We're looking at our work kind of with new eyes, a new lens, with a lens of faith. In other words, how do we bring our faith into our workplace? And sometimes that can be a challenge because our workplaces, the values that kind of are there in that environment are different than what we personally have. And then there's this conflict that goes on. If that's you, that you are in... you're in good company. At least in the Bible, you see this all the time. One example is Daniel. Daniel in the lion's den. You may remember that story. Before he ended, the lion's den was part of his bad work scenario. That's a bad work scenario when you end up in a lion's den. But his story is he was in Israel with his buds. They end up going to this place called Babylon, another country. They were exiled there. They were forced there. They didn't want to go. But he ends up, not like everybody, but in his particular case, he ends up with a good job. Some of his friends, they get a good job, but there's still all this conflict. There's still these big cultural divides and values divides, and it affects how he eats, how he prays, all kinds of things. And as I said, the inner office politics gets so bad for Daniel, he ends up getting thrown into a lion's den. But God protects him, if you know that story. But it's all kinds of challenges with him and his friends, and they're trying to live out their faith in a pretty hostile environment. And then they get a letter from the prophet Jeremiah. He's still back in Israel. And he writes them a letter, and they get it, and you can just imagine, they open it up, and they think, this is awesome. You know, this is a prophet. He's talking from God. God's probably saying, that crappy, horrible job you got, it's going to be over, you know, by the end of the year. You're going to get this new job that's great paying, and you're going to love it, using all your skill sets, no clash with the values. But that's not what it says. He opens up this letter, and it says, you better get comfortable. Well, I hate this job. I don't want to get comfortable. Get comfortable, and it's going to be a while. You're going to have this job for a while. Then in part of the letter, notice at the top of your outline, it says this in verse 7. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which you have been carried to in exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. That's what it says. It says, I'm supposed to pray for my employers that are in Babylon. I'm supposed to pray for these people that have values totally different than mine. That's why today's message is talking about working in Babylon. Because our Babylon today sometimes is real similar to then. It's not called Babylon, but it's a secular employment. Their values are different than our values. There's agitation or just outright hostility to our faith. How do you work through that? Well, we bring something to the table. We bring something, and we want to avoid getting sucked into the values of Babylon, values that are different than ours. 7 things that we can do to avoid that. 7 things. They're actually sins when we allow ourselves to do it. So the 7 sins in the workplace we want to avoid. Number 1 is the sin of sloth. slothfulness. That word's kind of cool. Sloth. I mean, we know who uses that word. We have an animal called sloth, right? He's slow. That's what it means. Now, you're slow. It's not on your outline, but Romans 12:11 says, do not be slothful in business. It says it shouldn't be there. But it happens, right? I've done some interviewing. Some of you have been in a position where you've interviewed for future employees. Maybe you're in HR. And what's interesting is nobody ever says, yeah, I'm a sloth. You know, it's not on the resume. You know, I'm a sloth. Nobody ever says, I'm just super lazy. If you hire me, I'm going to be wandering around the hallways, lazy as snot. You know, no, they don't say that. What they say is, when you ask them, like, what's your biggest weakness? They go, I work too much. I work too hard. I have problems with boundaries because I just love to work for my employer. You know, they read that on the internet or something. Not everybody actually believes that. It's not true about everybody. They find their way in, and then they're lazy, you know, and it becomes a problem. Proverbs says, the sluggard does not plow in the autumn. He will seek at harvest and have nothing. In other words, the person who's lazy wonders, where's my raise? You know, where's my promotion? Why did she get that promotion? The answer is because you're a sloth, but they don't want to hear that. You know, they don't get it. I mentioned last week about the Gallup survey that was reported in the U.S. News Today and in other places, but they're talking about how the majority of Americans are disengaged. They're not fully on board. They're just kind of like out there. They describe it using a military term, which the military term is retired but on active deployment. Road warriors is what they stand for. Road warriors. Retired but on active. In other words, you're still there, but you're really not. You're like retired in your mind. A Gallup worker, his name is David Beck, worked with over 10,000 employees at the IRS, which is not an easy job to work for, I'd imagine. I mean, most people, they're not happy when you get a call from the IRS, right? And so they found that most of the people working for the IRS were very unhappy with their job. That may not surprise you. I mean, over and over, people said, I hate my job, and I only have 20 years left. That's not a thank God it's Monday type of day. That's like 20 years can go. If you hate your job, 20 years is a long 20 years. By way of contrast, you have a story in Genesis chapter 24. This guy Abraham sends his servant to go look for a wife for his son Isaac. Now, that's how they did it in those days. So his servant goes and travels in this caravan across the desert a long way to go to look for this woman for his for his boss's son. And he's got like 10 camels. It's a big caravan. He shows up at this town. And he's thirsty, he isn't drunk, he didn't, and so he sees this young woman. Her name's Rebecca. He sees her, and he's real polite. He says, hey, could I have some of the water from your jar? She just pulled some out of a well. They didn't have restaurants in those days. So she pulls water out of, she has this jar, and she goes, sure, you can have some water. And she goes, and also, let me give all of your camels something to drink as well. Now, that's above and beyond. He didn't ask for that. She didn't even know it's a test. He was praying about it, saying, God, show me who the woman is for my master's son. And because of that, because she goes above and beyond and then some, which is a big and then some, we can just read that, 10 camels. You know how much a camel can drink? After a trip, it can drink up to 30 gallons of water. 30 gallons times 10, that's 300 gallons of water out of a well. This gal, man, she's got biceps, man. I mean, she's... I'll do that. Looking for a good workout anyways, you know. Pulls this water out, feeds, you know, gives all this water to the camels. Because she did that, because she went above and beyond, that sent her on the adventure of a lifetime. She didn't even know that at the time. But that was the moment when she went above and beyond. And she ended up meeting her husband and becoming a matriarch of Israel. People look back and they name their daughters after her, and the blessing that they pray blessings from her and over her, and all of that. She didn't know that, and it's because of then and then some. She went above and beyond. See, that's the attitude that starkly different than the attitude of just kind of going through the motions, disengaged. One of the ways we stay engaged, one of the ways that we don't find ourselves getting lazy or slothful is in our faith. Sometimes we can separate this and we think, our work's over here and then my faith's over here. But they're actually, we are on mission. Wherever we're at, we're on mission. And we bring our faith into the workplace. Now, there's some faith-friendly places like Chick-fil-A, of course, Service Masters. And there's other places where they're faith-friendly, where you can have fellowships. And there are fellowships, Christian fellowships, where they meet at the break room, they meet on premises like Coca-Cola, Tyson Foods, Southwest Airlines, Ford, FedEx, Domino's Pizza. There's also government agencies like the Center for Disease Control that has Christian groups. It's because people stood up and said, hey, we want this. We want to have a place to be able to talk about our faith. And then there's also in different work environments. It looks different for everybody. I want you to hear the story of somebody in our church who looks for opportunities. Sometimes he doesn't get paid at all because he's just looking for sharing his faith. This is his story. Listen, member of our church.
Hi, my name is Hank Miller. I've been a member of the Vineyard Community Church now for almost 20 years. I own a restoration company called 911 Restoration, and over the 20 years I've learned that the Bible is the most important thing that I can use as a tool in my toolbox. I pray every single day that, Lord, that you will use me today in my workplace and be able to help the people that I'm going to meet. So this particular day, I had just finished doing my devotions in the morning and was asking the Lord, what can I do? And sure enough, the phone rings in my office. And so I picked up the phone and I met a lady that had a mold problem underneath a sink in her kitchen. She then proceeds to talk to me about this mold issue, and as she's saying it, fear starts to begin to grip her and she begins crying on the phone. As she calms down, she then comes out and says that she's scared to death of mold. The mold was in her sink area, and she was scared to even walk into the kitchen as a result. Her husband had suggested to cleaning the mold with bleach, which is all wrong, but that's okay because that's the consumer's idea of how to fix mold. And she wouldn't allow him to do that because she has a breathing problem that the bleach will cause a reaction to her lungs, and so they can't even put the bleach. So she was petrified. And so we went through the process. I was trying to explain to her, and as we're talking to one another, I begin to hear the Lord speak to me to tell, this is your opportunity. I'm now giving it to you. So I tell the lady, I said, hey, I'm a Christian. I have a God that I believe in. He's a God of peace. He's a God of healing. And would it be okay if I prayed for you? And as soon as I said that, she began crying again. After that, she had calmed down. She then came out of that, and she told me that she was a worship leader in a church, a very large church in this area, for over 20 years. And that one day, she became so fearful being on the stage worshiping of the germs that were jumping off of people and that were on the stage that she couldn't take it another second. She literally just walked away from the job right there on the spot. So now this is now 5 years later, and she has been in her house ever since. She told me she left the house only a few times over those 5 years, that her children and her family or her husband, they've suffered because she won't do anything with them. She doesn't go to church. She doesn't do anything anymore except stay in her house. And as I began to tell her about the mold and what we can do to get rid of it, she started crying again, and it became very fearful again for her. And the Lord said to pray for healing for that mold. So I said, well, can we pray now? And she agreed, and I prayed for the mold, and it was a very simple prayer. Lord, heal her of her fear of mold. Bring peace into her body. And instantly, I heard the phone drop, and she disappeared, and I could hear in the background, and she started singing, hallelujah, Jesus, over and over. And the voice was incredible. And she comes back to the phone. She goes, I just walked up and down the stairs for the first time in 5 years, and I can breathe. I have no issues with my breath. I feel just this power that's come over me, and I'm able to breathe again. Hallelujah. Thank you, Hank. Thank you. So we're talking more about mold now and how to get rid of it, and I explained to her what we can do to get rid of it, and all of a sudden she's getting upset again now. And now I can tell that this phobia, this fear of germs is just consumed her. So again, I said, can we pray one more time? I feel like the Lord wants to share something. And so I did, and I began to pray. And it was another very simple prayer. Lord, heal her of her fear of mold and of germs, and bring your peace into her life right now in the name of Jesus. Amen. And there she goes again. Hallelujah. God, praise God. And then she comes back on the phone again, and she's calmed down, and now we are talking mold. And I explained to her what we need to do. And she goes, so I said, so I need you to tell me, though, where the mold is and where it's coming from in the sink. And as she goes underneath the sink to look underneath there, there wasn't one single speck of mold that she could find anywhere underneath the sink. So it was such an encouragement to me. I know God, the way he works, he's such a genius. He always puts two people together, whether you're the person that needs prayer or the person that needs to give prayer. But he is so smart that he kills two birds with one stone. And that's what happened for me that day. So guys, I just want to encourage you that in your workplace, challenge you that if you are willing to ask God to use you today, that he will open up plenty of opportunities for that to happen. It's just you need to give him permission to speak into your life and to allow him to use you. And that's what we come to church for. That's why we read our Bibles, is because those are not just good stories and a place to hang out with a bunch of nice people. Those are the training grounds for our real world, where we go out in this world and we share the gospel with everybody that we meet.
Great story, huh? I mean, he could have just gone on and, you know, mold, treated it, all the textbook stuff. But he had eyes, and you can do that as well. You can have eyes. How can I bring my faith into the workplace? You might say, well, Andy, I don't own my own business. I can't call those shots. In fact, my boss told me I can't share. It's against the policy. It's against the rules of our organization to share our faith. Well, if that's what's been told to you, if you're in a corporation, they would said you can't share your faith, you need to know that that's illegal, that it is your legal right in Title VII, an Equal Employment Opportunity Act, to share your faith. Now, you can't harass other employees, but you have a legal right to share your faith in your place of employment. And beyond that, beyond the law, we're on mission. We have a mission that God's put us on to share our story and what God's doing in our lives and look for opportunities. Okay, next, the sin of pride. The sin of pride. God is opposed to the human system that we use to put certain jobs on a pedestal. Like certain jobs have certain status and dignity and other ones don't. That's not the way God views it. We looked at that last week. God is a God of work. It's unique to in ancient Israel that God worked. Other gods didn't work, but God, the God of Israel, Yahweh, he was a working God, loved work, and his people work. And their little boys are trained with trades, and young girls they work. And really, the Bible, among other things, it's a book about work. That work is a constant theme because it's important. Interesting, one scholar said that there's over 200 occupations that he counted in the Bible, and just among the jobs that begin with C, are that you can find in the Bible are these, okay? It includes camel drivers, candy makers, captains, caravan chiefs, carpet makers, cattlemen, census takers, charioteers, cheese makers, choir masters, circumcisers. That doesn't sound like a good job to me, but to each his own, right? Clothiers, cooks, coppersmiths, counselors, counterfeiters. That's not an approved job. It's just in the Bible, though. Cupbearers, custodians, and custom clerks. Those are just jobs that begin with C, which is the most important. They're all important. You know, even the king was expected to be among the rank and file. Moses predicting that, saying, hey, eventually God's going to bring you a king. They didn't have a king at the time. And he says about the king, notice he says, the king must not consider himself, what? Better than his fellow Israelites, and turn from the law to the right or to the left. See, in the work in Babylon, the CEO, the person who's in charge, they're better, right? They're better than everybody else. But God says, that's not the way it is. That's not, in fact, he resists that. All throughout the Bible, you see this constant theme, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. He resists that. He's against that. Part of the reason is because when we show favoritism like that, it hurts people. It hurts people. Now, nobody knows what's going on in your own attitude, in your own heart, except you, but you just take your own self-test. And you ask yourself, and like, including myself, you know, if I go and talk to somebody and I ask them, hey, what do you do for a living? And they tell me, nothing wrong with that question. But they tell me, and then when they tell me, if I think to myself, oh, wow, that job has a lot of status. That job has a lot of influence. That job, you know, that maybe I should lean in and really listen, and maybe I should, you know, give extra eye contact, and this person could help me in my own portfolio in some way. You know, they're people of influence. And then if somebody else says some other job that I deem less important, oh, well, maybe I disengage. How much time should I give them? I'm getting busy. I have other things to do. God says he resists that. That's the world system. Every job has value. God doesn't put one job over another job. Number three, the sin of unethical action. When we're unethical, ethics are important. Paul writes to the Ephesians, he says, anyone who has been stealing, he had gone to Ephesus, he brought the gospel there. Certainly there were some thieves. He was just like taking it for granted. I know some of you were thieves. And there's more than just being like a burglar. I mean, you know, that you can steal stuff from work. You can steal stuff from the government. There's all kinds of thievery. He says, must steal no longer, but must work. In other words, work's a good thing. Doing something useful with your hands. Why? That they may have something to share with those in need. See, we are made to share. Part of the reason we work is not just to meet our own needs and the needs of our family, but so that we have something to share. We bring something good to the community. So we're sure. And we need to make sure we don't fall into unethical behavior. That we don't cheat on the expense account. That it's tax season now. That we don't cheat and try to color outside the lines on our taxes. That we don't lie to somebody when we come back after we've been gone for a few hours. And they say, hey, where have you been? And then we think, I'm kind of embarrassed to tell them really where I've been. Because we didn't really honor our the time of when we were being paid. We don't take home office supplies when nobody else is looking, but we know they're not ours. We don't make inappropriate sexual comments to somebody. We're not demeaning to somebody who's lower on the org chart. We don't hold a grudge against somebody. We don't gossip against somebody that we know it's going to hurt them. These are the kinds of things that we want to, that might be part of the way Babylon works, but it's not the way we work. God sets the bar very high. He says, live like shining stars above reproach in a dark world. He says, it's a dark world. There's a lot of moral decay. It's Black History Month this month, and I came across this week a quote by Martin Luther King Jr. Here's what he said, talking about moral decay. He said, but there are some things in our social system which I am proud to be maladjusted, and to which I suggest that you too ought to be maladjusted. I never intend to adjust myself to the viciousness of mob rule. I never intend to adjust myself to the evils of segregation and the crippling effects of discrimination. I never intend to adjust myself to the tragic inequalities of an economic system which takes necessities from the masses to give luxuries to the classes. I never intend to become adjusted to the madness of militarism and the self-defeating method of physical violence. I call upon you to be maladjusted. The world is in desperate need of such maladjustment. Through such maladjustments, we will be able to emerge from the bleak and desolate midnight of man's inhumanity to man into the bright and glittering daybreak of freedom and justice. In other words, you don't conform to the world's standards. You stand apart from that. You say, you know what? I'm not going to fall into the sin of unethical action, even though the world around you might be doing that. And then you ask yourself, what am I doing in my faith, in my actions, in my behavior, to help influence my workplace? I want to show you one other video. This one's a little shorter. Another member in our church, about how he implements his faith in his workplace, but also with his clients. Watch this.
I own a small business. We are a government contractor. We have about 12 people at my company, and they come from all diverse backgrounds. Some Christian, some atheist, some other religions. And so it can be a challenge to live out and speak out our faith. We're very fortunate because I own the business, and I feel fortunate that I can make up some of the rules that we follow in the type of culture we create there. However, with all businesses, there are struggles, and the struggles can be in many forms. One of them is with problem employees, and having worked with people for a year or 2 years and then seeing their performance deteriorate and then having to talk to them, not so much as a coworker, but as a supervisor, can be a hard thing to do. And I think that's true for anybody that's in a supervisory position. One of the main Christian values that we try to demonstrate at our workplace is compassion and empathy. So what we try to do is be understanding, supportive of their concerns for their family and for their personal health. And we feel that that is one way that we can demonstrate love and compassion in the way that I believe Christianity and Jesus would have wanted us to. In the business world, it is very competitive. Every business is always trying to steal market share from the other business. And that can be very challenging, very fearful, and very scary for me as a business owner. And so to drive the fear away, I reflect on the 23rd Psalm, and I'll say that daily, sometimes 3 or 4 times a day, and turn over those fears to God and be actually joyful and grateful for people in business that succeed, because I know over time we will win and what we need will be provided. God has a plan for each of us individually, and God has a plan for every business. And that if we try to follow God's will in everything we do, and that is in my personal relationships, in my personal life, that God is going to reward that in a way that will reflect His glory and meet all of my needs and the needs of the people I love.
Another great story, another example of how to implement your faith and not get sucked up into the unethical behaviors of others. Marty, I don't know if you noticed that, but he said he prays for his competitors. And he told me offline, he said, you know, not everybody's honest out there, but he still prays for them. And he doesn't rejoice when they do poorly. He actually rejoices when they do well, which is the biblical way to handle it. The Bible says that it's not loving to rejoice when somebody else does poorly. And so making sure we bring in the ethical aspect. Number 4, the sin of work idolatry. Now, this one can be painful. So no elbowing the person next to you, you know, saying, hey, this is you. Okay, because the truth is, it can be this idea of work, it can become an idol. Now, ancient days, the idols were like Baal or Molech, these different gods. Today, it's more likely an idol will be called success or achieve. And at the altar of success, we sacrifice time with our kids or our families. And what's ironic is we'll say, oh, we're working so hard to achieve stuff for them. And we actually believe that sometimes. We believe that. No, they don't believe it, but we believe it. We tell ourselves that's why we're doing it. And we've got to be careful that we don't fall into that, because kingdom priorities are different than Babylon's priorities. Kingdom priorities, the Bible says that there's a priority list. First thing in your life is God. The Bible says that love the Lord your God with all your strength, all your soul, all your might. And this is the greatest of commandments. And so this is the first thing. But then after that, if you're married, is your marriage. That's first. Or second, should I say. It's first above the kids. Then next after that, if you have kids, then that's your next priority. So you have God, you have marriage, you have your kids. The Bible says love your kids and don't neglect them. And then the fourth is work. Work. Now here's what you need to know about work. You probably already discovered this. Work doesn't like being fourth. Work likes being number one. So work's always, he's not happy there. He feels like he's being punished. Man, I don't belong down here. I belong at the top. And so he's always trying to work his way to the top. And you've got to beat him down. No, God's number one. If I'm married, then it's my spouse, then my kids, then work. And we've got to be careful that we don't fall into that. Because work doesn't want that position. The work wants number one in your life. You might think, well, Andy, I got that under control. Man, that pyramid, no problemo for me. And I hope that's true. If that's true, awesome. But here's a way to test it. If you're married, you can ask later today, not today, not now, but later today, go up to your spouse and say, you know what, that pyramid? I'm nailing it, aren't I? But if I'm not, I want you to tell me the truth. You know, is there anywhere where I'm like neglecting you or the kids and putting work above that? Now, that's a pretty dangerous thing to do because you might be surprised. But if you're open and you're honest and you're willing to hear that, that could save you a lot of regret. A lot of regret, especially, you know, when you're at your dying days. People call me when they're on their deathbed. I guess that's one of my jobs as a pastor. You know, what else are you going to do? You're entering into eternity. I've been to a number of talking to people when they're on their deathbeds, and there's a lot of regrets. Don't be that person. You can make a decision now that you don't have to be that person filled with regrets of how you lived your life. But it's all about getting your priorities straight, making sure that you don't neglect young ones and the influence you can have in their life. And God will just bless that effort and make it go, you know, but and make it be really abundant. I love this language about making a deal. Jesus says, you know, kind of it's a work type language. What kind of deal is it to get everything you want, but lose your soul, lose your life, lose your family, lose what's important? It's no deal at all. You can get it all, and if you lose those things that are important, says you've lost, and that's incredibly unfortunate. If you're a parent that's courageous enough to reprioritize your schedule and to put your kids in the proper place above work, you will probably not get a lot of fanfare at work. You might not get the award and the employee of the year, but I am telling you, you will be keeping yourself from a whole bunch of regret later on. But you also get praise from God. God says, that's the way I want you to live your life. And our church supports that. And I want to let you know, you are a hero if you do that. Number five, the sin of avoiding accountability. Avoiding accountability. Jesus told a lot of stories and parables about work. One of those was about three workers, three employees. Their employer had given them some money, some resources, opportunity, and a time frame, and then left them. And the hinge of this story is when the employer comes back, and then it's a day of accounting. Says, I want to know how you did. Two of those employees did well. They took their resources, the opportunity, the time given them. They did well. They made a profit for their boss. The third one did not. He dropped the ball. He didn't do anything. And he doesn't own up to it. He's filled with excuses. He says, Master, I know you have high standards and hate careless ways, that you demand the best and make no allowances for error. I was afraid I might disappoint you. Here he's a worker. He doesn't do what he's told to do. He does a poor job, and he blames his boss. It's actually your fault. You're a hard guy to work with. You're a hard guy to please. Do you know anybody like that? You know, they're not doing their job. They're doing a poor job. And then they blame everybody else. You know, it's my team. I don't want a bad team. I had a better team to work with. Bad employer. If I got paid more money. If I had a different job. And they all kinds of excuses. And listen, if you work in an environment where everybody's making excuses and blaming each other, that is a toxic environment for the workplace. You may not be able to control that, but you can control yourself. You don't have to participate in it. Don't get to go around blaming other people. You know what blame stands for? It stands for being lame. Blame. Don't be lame. Don't blame. Don't get into all that. It's like the CEO who's just stepping into this new job as CEO, and the outgoing CEO said, hey, things can get tough from time to time. When you're at a real tough place, real big problem. I've drawn up three envelopes. Just you can open up those envelopes, they'll tell what you do. And I put them in order, 1, 2, and 3. First, and so he did that. So the guy left, first big problem that came up, he went to envelope number one, opened it up, said, blame me. He thought, well, that's nice of that guy. He's letting me blame him. So he blamed him. He goes, it's the exiting CEO. It's his fault. Everybody goes, oh, okay, I guess so. Next, things go okay for a while. Next problem that comes up, he goes through his envelope in the desk, opens it up. It says, blame the board. He thought, hey, that's a good idea. So he says, it's the board of executives. They don't give me enough power. I wasn't resourced well. And he goes in and blames the board. Everybody goes, oh, okay, I guess so. Next big problem that comes up down the road, he goes, oh, no, I better go get that third envelope. Runs, opens it up, says, prepare three envelopes. You know, there's no more excuses. Eventually, it runs out. You can't blame anybody else. And so don't get into that. Exodus 32 is a great example of how this happens in the Bible. Moses he's going to Aaron. He appoints him. Moses is the leader. Like any good leader, he delegates. He's got to go and spend some time with God, get some instructions. And he says, Aaron, make sure these guys stay on track spiritually. He comes back later, Moses does, and Aaron has not done his job. They're like worshiping this golden calf. So he confronts him. He says, what did this people do to you that has brought such a great sin upon them? Aaron says this. Now notice his response. Do not let the anger of my Lord burn hot. You know the people, that they are bent on evil. They said to me, in other words, it's not my idea. Make us gods. Who shall go before us? As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land, we do not know what has become of him. So I said to them, whoever has gold, take it off. So they gave it to me, and I threw it into the fire, and out came this calf. In other words, he goes, yeah, I don't even know how it happened. We just threw in this gold, and this calf comes hopping out. Moses doesn't buy it. He goes, no, Aaron, you know, you're making excuses. You're making excuses. So it's easy to blame other people. It's easy, but don't fall into that. Number 6, the sin of a bad attitude. Now, it is true that having a bad attitude is sin. It's not what God wants for you. We're not supposed to have a bad attitude. In fact, in the Bible, there's in the Old Testament, only one person does it say that God's spirit, he was filled with God's spirit. Only one person. It wasn't somebody famous like you'd think, like, you know, Noah. Who was it? You know, was it Moses or, you know, David, King David, or Solomon or Daniel? No, it's none of those people. Look what the Bible says. It's somebody you probably have not heard of. The Lord said to Moses, see, I have chosen Bezalel, son of Uri, and the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah. He's saying, making sure this is the right guy. And I filled him with the Spirit of God, with wisdom, with understanding, with knowledge, and with all kinds of skills. To do what? To prophesy, to teach what? No. To make artistic designs for work in gold, silver, bronze, to cut and set stones, and to work in wood, and to engage in all kinds of crafts. He says this trade of being a craftsman, of being a jeweler, just basic trades, he goes, I'm going to empower them with my spirit. Why would he do that? Because God loves excellence. Excellence, not just for presidents of companies and management teams, but excellence at every level. God loves initiative, creativity, loves excellence. And that's part of the way that we demonstrate we get this right. I think that, and it's not just at work, but in all aspects of work, like writing emails. If you're writing an email, I think God loves excellent written emails. You take the time to write. Sometimes I get emails that I don't think people are putting this value of excellence into it. It's like hard to read. They're not valuing my time. Part of me just wants to reply and say, God hates bad emails. Poorly written emails. I haven't done it yet, but I've thought about it. Because God loves excellence. I think God loves excellent run meetings. Meetings that are run well. Bad meetings? No. Hell is filled with bad meetings. Hell is one bad meeting after another. God loves well-run teams, well-led teams. If you're a leader, it's all the leaders I know, including myself. I don't mind being on a team. I don't have to be the leader. I want it run. I want it led well, though. There's nothing more frustrating than a poorly led team. God loves well-led teams. God loves well-run emergency rooms where things are run well and in work environments. God loves well-baked bread, well-cleaned sinks, well-driven buses, well-designed apps, well-taught classes, genuine friendly reception desks. God loves well-groomed landscapes and gardens. And so we give God our best. Sometimes we don't need a greater job. We just need to do a greater job at our job with more love. And then number seven, the last one, is the sin of 24/7ism. 24/7ism. Sometimes we think if we're busy, we equate busyness with importance. Because important people are always busy, right? So if I'm busy, I must be important. So we're just always busy. There was a bumper sticker years ago people would put on their car, and it said, Jesus is coming back. Look busy. I don't think that's the way it works. It's not just looking busy. We actually, we need to do things well and do things right. And if you look in the creation account, God sets up a system from the very beginning to help us to disengage from work. So we're not always busy, always working. And that's the Sabbath. The Sabbath. We see that from the very beginning. He says, God blessed the seventh day and made it holy because on it he rested from the work he created that he had done. And then later on in Exodus, he says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Holy is not like holier than thou. Holy actually means to separate. To separate out. And you see this in the creation account. The creation account is about taking chaos and creating order. That's what Genesis 1 and 2 is about. Chaos to order, because in the ancient world, chaos worked against humanity and things working well and progressing when we were in chaos. And so order was what God brings to the table. He brings order. And you see him separating out. He separates the dark from the light. He separates the waters from the land, the sky from the earth. He's separating out. And at the end of each one of those, he evaluates. Each day he evaluates and says, it is good. So there's like an evaluation. And then he creates a finish line on the seventh day. And the last thing he separates out is labor from leisure. Labor from leisure says, okay, there's the Sabbath. And this is the rhythm that we need to work in. And the way God designed it, he hardwired it into the universe. He hardwired it into us. That we need to be able to separate ourselves out. And it's getting harder and harder nowadays. It's so hard because it seems like we're always working. Facebook and Twitter say that their sites are most active during the working hours. Most people don't have a job that needs Facebook. One author said, we live in a cult of connectivity, so we're both always working and never really fully working. You're just always working. We carry it with us, our work. All the emails and the texts, and we're just working and we work and we work and we work. God says, no, that's not the way I designed you. You need to be able to disengage. Have a finish line in your life, and that's the Sabbath. And you rest on the Sabbath. You say, well, what does that look like? Well, it looks different for different people, but you rest. It's not work for that. That's the one thing it has in common for all of us. And so on the Sabbath, you don't work. You don't plan for work. You don't dream about work. You don't think about work. You don't work. You don't even say the word work. So what do I do? Well, you might, on a day like this, you could go to the beach, walk on the beach. Go take a canoe ride on Northwest River Park and go relax, play with your kids in a park. There's all kinds of things you can do. Read a book, whatever's, but it's not work. But you go and you refresh and you renew yourself. This is part of the way God wants us to be restored. And part of a Sabbath, of course, is connecting with God as well. Jesus said, come to me, all you who are who labor and are heavy laden, and you will find rest for your souls. That's what God wants to do. He says, I want to satisfy you deep inside. Maybe do something different. Change things up. Where is God telling you right now that it's time for you to change something? We looked at seven different things. You might say, Handy, all seven I could work on. Well, that's fine. But certainly everybody here, there's something we can change up and say, God, I need to maybe reprioritize some things. I want to make sure and redefine work as you define it, to not lose sight of the mission that you've given me. And we bring that to the workplace. Let's bow our heads and pray. Well, right now I'm going to ask you, if God was speaking to you, particularly when he said, if you're weary and heavy laden, those are work terms. Maybe you've been juggling a lot of stuff. Maybe you got a lot of financial stuff going on, a lot of stressors in your life. Jesus has a word for you. He says, if you are weary and heavy laden, what is the answer? He says, come to me. That's what he's doing. He's asking you right now. He says, Jesus is saying, come to me. So I'm going to ask you to pray that. You're just going to say, God, I'm going to come to you right now. It doesn't mean you're joining the church. I'm not going to have you come forward. I'm just right where you're at, where you pray. Say, today I'm going to come to Jesus. I'm going to take him up. That's an invitation. I'm taking him up on his invitation to me. Pray that right now. Would you say, God, I'm coming to you. Right where you're at, just pray that in your mind. I'm coming to you to receive renewed life. Thank you for the work on the cross, the greatest work in the universe. Would you say, God, thank you for the work on the cross. I ask for forgiveness and a new start. For those of you who maybe you have some regret, maybe your kids are older and you're looking at it and you're going, I miss some of that stuff. God doesn't want you to get stuck where you're at in regrets, looking back in the rearview mirror. Nobody parents perfectly. Nobody is a perfect kid. Nobody's a perfect employer. Nobody's a perfect employee. That's why we need Christ to come and just give us that forgiveness of sins, and we walk with a clear conscience. So, Lord, I pray a clear conscience upon everybody here. Lord, I pray for everyone who works for a secular company, a place that is not friendly to the gospel. Lord, that each person here, they would not lose their mission. That you would pray for the peace and the prosperity of that company. That you would pray, that you would seek the peace and prosperity of that company. That you would not be idle in the way you do it. That you would honor all the jobs. No matter what your job is, God says, that job has value. That job has dignity. Would you say, God, help me to be like Rebecca and go above and beyond the and then some. And watch how that unlocks kingdom blessings in my life. Say, God, help me to not conform to the world's standards, no matter if everybody else is doing it. God, help me to have priorities where you are first, my marriage is second, my kids are third, and then work. And say, God, help me not to make a bunch of excuses. I pray for those of you, if you're in a place where there's lots of blaming going on and that's a toxic environment, God, I just pray, Lord, that you would just insulate them from that. Help them to rise above that. Lord, help us to value excellent work like you do, that we work for you. And Lord, I pray for those of us who are struggling with having the rhythm of the Sabbath. Lord, I pray that would become a reality for us. We would honor the Sabbath. We'd spend time with you. We'd spend time with people we love. And we'd let you refresh us on that day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. We hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to write us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. And we'll see you next week.